Okay, so let's start. So the first thing that we're going to learn is spherical equivalence. The spherical equivalent is a spherical lens which places any astigmatic eye in a condition of meridional balance. That is, it changes the astigmatism into equally mixed astigmatism and produces retinal images made up of diffusion circles. Now, what we need to learn is, how do you calculate spherical equivalence? So it's as simple as, take half the cylindrical power, add it to the sphere algebraically, and drop the remaining cylinder and axis. It is just converting an astigmatic lens into a spherical lens. So for example, you have a plus one diopter sphere with a minus two diopter cylinder across 180 degrees. How do you make this into a spherically equivalent lens? Half the cylinder would be what? Minus one. You algebraically add the sphere and the cylinder. What do you get? Zero. So ultimately, you get a plano lens. Why do we need to know what is a spherical equivalent? Say you did a cataract surgery. You do the refraction, and you get a plus one diopter sphere with a minus two diopter cylinder across 180, as in the previous example. You took all the possible measures and made sure he had minimal refractive error, but still he has this refractive error. Did you mess up? No. The spherical equivalent here is a plano sphere. A second use could be, say a patient comes in with a torn contact lens. He tells you that he wears toric contact lenses and urgently needs a new set of lenses. He gives you the refraction as a minus two diopter sphere with a minus 1.5 diopter cylinder across 90. You don't have the exact stock of lens. Can you help him? Yes, you can. Can someone tell me what you would give? Exactly. It's a minus two diopter spherical contact lens which you can give for such a refraction. 2.75.
Okay, one more. In the first option, you were wondering why you got so much of plus and so much of cylinder. So when you have a cylinder, obviously there is a little bit of plus power also. If you see high cylinders, when there is a tight suture, minus six cylinder with a plus two sphere, or plus three sphere. And when that cylinder goes, that plus also goes. That's what we see. So when you take the equivalent, it comes out to be plano over here. So you didn't want that cylinder, so you put a spherical equivalent. The second place also, you couldn't give a cylinder because you didn't have a toric lens. So you took an equivalent and gave a spherical contact lens. One other place where you will use, there are many, one other which I have mentioned to you. Do you know what is the maximum amount of cylinder that can be prescribed in a spectacle or made in a spectacle easily? Around minus four.
Minus four.
So when there is more than minus four cylinder, what do? You take the equivalent and it's like when you're doing your refraction itself, if you find that it's more than four cylinder, please do not prescribe that. Try to put it on as a spherical equivalent and see what your patient reads and write that separately. Besides what, if at minus eight, the patient reads 6.6. With a minus four, how much does the patient read with that spherical added on to your original spherical? So that'll help you find out what can be prescribed. They cannot make a high cylinder more than six whatsoever. And it'll cause a lot of distortions. Okay, and you'll know how that spectacle will look. So in that place also, you should remember that you can use the spherical equivalent. So if I had a minus eight cylinder, that's a little too much, okay? Minus six cylinder, and I can give only minus four cylinder. So what will I do? That extra two cylinder is made into spherical, which is one minus, and that is added to my sphere. So if I had a spherical of plus two, it becomes plus one. If it was a minus two, it becomes minus three. So it becomes a minus three with a minus four cylinder. That's what you will be prescribing to the patient.
So these are your three examples. Please try to put spherical equivalence for these lenses. Yeah.
So the
The first one is plus 5.75. The plus seven minus half of 2.5. That gives you a plus 5.75. The second is minus five plus 0.5. That is minus 4.5. And the third is a plano lens, just divide the cylinder into half. So that's a minus 2, 2.125, but that's 2. Moving on. Transposition. What is transposition? When a lens prescription is changed from one lens form to another optically equivalent form, it is called transposition. First, we read the simple transposition of spheres. This is the alteration of lens form of spherical lenses. The lens power is given by the algebraic sum of surface powers. For example, a plus 3 diopter sphere. It could be a plano-convex lens with a 0 and plus 3, or it could be a double convex lens with powers of plus 1.5 on either surfaces, or it could be a concavo-convex lens with a minus 1.5 on one surface and plus 4.5 on the other, or a minus 6 and plus 9. Either way, ultimately, you need to get a plus 3 diopter.
Now, this is used for dispensing. So you'll have to put curvatures onto different surfaces to get the other surface's power. This is purely spherical. And when it's cylindrical, it's going to be varying in different portions.
Next, we come to simple transposition of cylinder. This is a change in the description of a toric astigmatic lens so that the cylinder is expressed in the opposite power. It is important if the examiner wishes to compare the present refraction with the previous prescription. Suppose a patient underwent refraction at a center where they use a plus cylinder form, while at your center you use a minus cylinder form. Use transposition of the cylinders to note for any change in refraction. For example, we have a lens here, which is, upon refraction, you get a plus 2 diopter spherical along 90 degrees and a plus 3 diopter along 180 degrees. So when we do, let's say we did a retinoscopy and these are the values we got. Now say you want the cylinder in plus cylinder form. So what we usually do here is a plus cylinder, plus 2, a sphere will be acting in all the meridians. The cylinder acts only along a particular meridian. So now here you can split plus 3 diopter into plus 2 and plus 1, correct? So you have a plus 2 diopter sphere acting in both the axes, and you have a plus 1 diopter sphere which is acting along 180. So here we get the prescription as a plus 2 diopter sphere with a plus 1 diopter cylinder oriented along 90 degrees so that its power acts along 180 degrees.
Okay, so used to it, okay. So you see that it is moving against, you put your minus cylinder there, you neutralize. And you find that it is still against, go on adding till it is completely neutralized. So you've put the cylinder axis vertical. How do you say the power is acting horizontal? Because you're moving it horizontally. You're actually streaking 180 by moving the vertical streak horizontally. So the power is working along 180, and that's what you neutralized. So this is the basis of your optical cross, right? Because you are streaking 180, the power is plus 3 along 180. But you would have put the, if suppose you neutralized it with a plus 3 cylinder, it would have been put how? Vertically. You would have put plus 3 vertical, only then you will write plus 3 in the horizontal. If it's a sphere, it's written on both the meridians. If it is a cylinder, it is written in the opposite meridian of where your axis is. And you now should have understood why. Right?
Now again, I'll explain it with a minus cylinder form. With a minus cylinder, let's take plus 3 diopter as your sphere, which means, forget all the meridians, put sphere plus 3 in both the axes, 90 and 180. What should you do at 90 now to get a plus 2, if there is a plus 3 already? Minus 1, correct? So now you have a minus 1 there. That is your cylinder. That is placed again along which axis? 180, because it must be acting along 90. In order to be acting along 90, it has to be placed along 180. Is that clear? Moving on. Now, what are the steps to transpose the cylinder? How do you get the new spherical power? The new spherical power is the algebraic addition of the sphere and the cylinder. The new cylindrical power is numerically the same as the old cylinder, but with an opposite power, opposite sign. And the new axis is just rotated along 90. That is, if the original axis was less than 90, you add 90 to it. If the original axis was more than 90, subtract 90 from it. Let's try it out. The first example, let's work it out together. You have a plus 4.5 diopter sphere with a minus 1.5 diopter cylinder across 90. What would be the new sphere? Plus 3 diopter sphere. What would be the power, what would be the sign of the new cylinder? The power is the same, plus 1.5. What would be the axis? 180. Next example. Now you all can work out the remaining three examples and we'll discuss the answer. Third one is minus 2. Plus minus 2. Minus 3. Minus 2. Yeah, so the second one is minus 3 diopter sphere with a plus 1 diopter cylinder across 80. The third one is a minus 2 diopter sphere with a plus 3 diopter cylinder across 90. And the final one is plus 1 diopter sphere with a minus 2.5 diopter cylinder across 110. Now next, we have toric transposition. Now this is a little complicated. What is a toric lens? A toric lens is one with a spherical, with one spherical surface and one toric surface, which contributes to this to the cylindrical power. A toric lens has two different powers in two different orientations, which are perpendicular to each other. So it resembles a cut section of a donut, where there are two regular radii, one is smaller than the other. The principal meridian of the weaker power of the toric surface is called the base curve of the lens, which must be specified if toric transposition is required. Now let's see what the toric formula is. Toric formula is always written as a fraction. The numerator is a surface power of the sphere. The denominator is the surface power and axis of the base curve, followed by the surface power and of the other meridian of the toric surface. Like I said before, the lesser power is the base curve. As you can see, between minus 8 and minus 6, we take minus 6 as the base curve. This is an example for it. So this toric lens is a plus 9 diopter sphere with a minus 6 diopter base curve, axis 90, and a minus 8 diopter cylinder, axis 180. Now, steps of toric transposition. It would be best if you note these steps down. Let's take an example. Let us transpose a plus 3 diopter sphere and a minus 1 diopter cylinder, axis 90, to a toric formula to the base curve of minus 5 diopters. The first rule, cylinder and base curve must be the same sign. Are they the same sign here? Yes, both are minus. There's a minus 1 diopter cylinder and minus 5 diopter base curve. The new sphere is the old sphere minus the base curve. So here we have a plus 3 minus minus 5. So our new sphere is a plus 8 diopter sphere. The new axis of the base curve. The new axis of the base curve is 90 degrees to the old axis. So here it becomes 180 degrees. Now the new cylinder is base curve plus the old cylinder. Here the base curve was minus 5 plus minus 1. So the new cylinder is minus 6. Now what is the new axis of the cylinder? It is the same as the old axis. So here it remains 90 degrees. So the axis, the base curve doesn't have an axis specified. We have to make a toric. So they gave us a lens of...
base curve is basically the curvature on which it is being made, which is the one surface. Suppose you're going to take only a single surface toric. Okay, a toric lens is something which has two different curvatures. If you'll go back to that donut. Did he give you that pointer?
He didn't give me the pointer.
Yeah. One sec. If you will see in, I'll speak from here. If you'll see, this is a steeper curve, right? And this is the flatter curve, right? So the flatter curve is your base curve, the lowest curve. So if you will take that example which was given,
this one.
See, in this one, if you will see, plus 3 is your sphere, and minus 1 is your cylinder, and its axis is 90, which means it is steepest at 90. If it's plus 3 on one meridian, it is flatter, and it is steeper on the 90. Ideally, if you'll see the cornea, it's the other way around. Okay? So now you want 90 to be the steepest. Fine? Because it has more cylinder. So when you're choosing a base curve, that should be the flatter one. So it cannot be 90. It'll be the opposite of it. That is why you make the base curve opposite of the existing cylinder. So that now the new cylinder which comes will be along what was already there. Otherwise, you won't have a cylinder at all in that correct axis which you want.
We move on. So the answer for this question would be, what is a new sphere? Plus 8 diopters. The new cylinder? Minus 5. And the new base curve is a minus 6. The new base curve is minus 5, and the new cylinder is a minus 6.
Okay, now take this itself. If you will take this plus 8 and minus 5, one surface is plus 8. The other surface is minus 5. If you'll remember that first thing where she said how you represent a sphere, take that as a spherical surface. Plus 8 and minus 5 will give you what? Plus 3. You've got that. Okay? You take this. Plus 8 and minus 6. What do you get? Plus 2. So one meridian is plus 3. The other meridian is plus 2. So if it's plus 3 and plus 2, you take plus 3 as the sphere. Plus 2 is the cylinder, right? So that's one cylinder, and it's going to be on the other axis. So it finally turns out to be the same thing, but you've given it in a toric form because there are two cylinders which are coming. Okay? One surface is spherical, and two cylinders coming on the other surface. There are two different powers coming in the two different meridians.
Okay, this will all get cleared with an example. Let's try transposing this toric surface. Please remember to go through the steps before you start transposing. Make sure the cylinder and the base curve are the same sign. Here the cylinder is a plus cylinder, the base curve is a minus. So convert the cylinder into a minus cylinder form, transpose cylinders. So by now, your new formula should be a plus 4 diopter cylinder with a minus 1 diopter, plus 4 diopter sphere with a minus 1 diopter cylinder across 180. And then you should go ahead with your transposition. Next, the new axis. It is 90 because you transpose the... Yeah. New axis of the base curve.
What she meant by new axis is what are you going to get?
New axis of the base curve, I said. Yeah. New cylinder, minus 7. And new axis of the cylinder, 180. So your final formula would be, final answer would be a plus 10 diopter sphere with a minus 6 diopter cylinder, axis 90 with a minus 7 diopter cylinder, axis 180.
Spherical equivalent is when you don't want that cylinder there. Okay, transposition is you have something. You have done it in plus cylinder form. I've done it in minus cylinder form. How do we say it the same way? Just changing it. Over there, it doesn't reduce. Plus 3 and plus 2 will remain plus 3 and plus 2. I'll write it plus 2 plus 1. You'll write it plus 3 minus 1. That's all.
So here, you'll use that formula of algebraically adding the sphere and cylinder, changing the sign of the old cylinder, changing the axis of the old cylinder. So algebraically plus 3, plus 1, plus 4, with a minus 1 cylinder, axis 180. That is your transposition of your formula. You're basically changing this plus cylinder form to a minus cylinder form.
Toric IOLs, you're going to do toric contact lenses. You want to know what base curve you're going to use for what? Single surface torics. So So there, you have one particular base curve. You're going to grind minus 5 onto one surface. Minus 6 over here, okay? Minus 6 onto one surface, plus 10 onto one surface. And onto another surface, you have to create an extra cylinder. How much cylinder? Minus 1. So that is minus 7. Minus 7 is going to be steeper. So after you've ground one surface, you grind the next surface. So how much do you have to do? Now suppose you have a patient who's already, why we usually say lenticular lenses, right? We say don't give bifocals for very high powers, right? We say give separate glasses. If you will see that prescription writing, I would have told you. Give separate glasses. Why? It's because they'll have a particular base curve. When you change the base curve, the magnification changes and it's very difficult to adapt. So there, if your patient comes with a difference in cylinder, and if you have to use the same base curve, you need to know what that curvature has got to be. Okay, so all this you won't do. You have a dispensing optician to do it for you. But just in case you need to, you can go and refer to this PPT. Okay? How do you give a power to a particular surface? Is by grinding it. Okay, so you are giving a cylinder. A cylinder doesn't have one curvature, but two curvatures. So one curvature, which is the flattest one, is your base curve. And then you can't make something flatter than what it is on the second surface. So you're going to make it steeper by grinding it more there. Yep. They have standards. You have a certain standards of, this is what, you'll have batches. You'll have lenses which are coming in certain base curves. You can decide which lens you're going to pick to grind that surface. If you have a plus 4 and you want to grind a lens, what surface will I give? There you can use it. Or if you know there are periscopic lenses, there are different types of lenses which come in different base curves. So for that, to calculate, it makes life easier. Why do we have to transpose? Is because you need to get it in a form. Okay, I have the cylindrical power of the patient. I have the sphere, I have the cylinder. I need a particular base curve. I have this parameter only. With this parameter, what curvature will I give to that other surface so that I'll get this power? If you will remember the first drawing, plus 3, plus 2, or plus 6, plus 4, or plus 6, plus 5, all these will give one diopter. What do I have? I have one with a plus 4 base curve. So I'll use plus 3.
Moving on. Now, how do you write prescriptions when they give you an optical cross in the exam? Let's say they give you a cross with a minus 1 diopter sphere. Everything is sphere here. And a minus 3 diopter sphere. What do you do? Before this, you need to understand a simple concept which I'll give based on minus lenses because it's easy, minus cylinders. So with minus cylinders, your lesser minus is your sphere or your higher plus is your sphere. And between a plus and a plus is your sphere. So between, let's... So if I'm going to tell you only about minus lenses, plus lenses, it becomes exact opposite. So for minus lenses, the lesser minus or the higher plus is your sphere, okay? So here you have a minus 1 and a minus 3. The lesser minus, which is your sphere here? Minus 1. Now what you need to do here is, you add minus 1 on both the axes, okay? Sorry.
So what was the rule that she spoke about? If you want to write the prescription in the minus cylinder form, if you have two pluses, the higher plus is your spherical. Only then the lower one can be written in the minus cylinder form. When you're done, I'll stop.
Okay.
And if you have two minuses, the lower minus is your sphere, so that there is more minus, and that I'll write as my cylinder. If I have a plus and a minus, plus is your sphere, so that minus can be in the minus form. If I have plano and plus, plus will be my sphere, so that plano to plus, that gap will be your cylinder. And if you have plano and minus, plano is your sphere. Okay, now people are wondering, when you have plano and one number, why are you talking about sphere?
Surrender.
Right? I saw some quizzical looks. Okay, so why you need something as a sphere is when you're writing it in one form and the other. When you write it at plus one and plano with a plus one, you transpose it, it becomes plus one with a minus one. So it still is having a cylinder. So when you transpose, it makes a difference. So we can make a
small... Okay, the same example, we'll just put it here.
Okay. So it's a minus one and minus three. Minus one, minus three, right? So we said, what is the sphere here? Minus one. So let's keep minus one, minus one. What should I do along this 180 axis to get a minus 3? Minus 2. Sphere. Now this is your sphere. This remaining is your cylinder. Now the cylinder is acting along which axis? 180. Where should it be placed? 90. What? So ultimately, what does your formula become? Minus one diopter sphere with minus two diopter cylinder at 90. That is how you write a prescription out of her. Now in plus cylinder, do the ulta. Take minus. So minus three here, minus three here. What should you do to minus three to get a minus one? Plus two. So this is your sphere. The plus two is acting along 90. It should be placed along? So what is your new formula? That's your answer. The last one, the other cylinder form will be minus 3 with a plus 4 axis 180. Now, how do you make an optical cross out of a prescription? Now, you're given a prescription, you have to make an optical cross out of it.
So, what's the first example?
It's minus 1 diopter sphere with a minus 2 diopter cylinder axis 90.
So, minus 1 goes to? Sphere goes to both axes. How much cylinder?
Minus two.
Minus two cylinder axis?
90.
90. 180. Totals to be? So if you transpose this, does it go to that? Minus one with a minus two cylinder? Axis,
as
90.
It's gone, okay.
So what's the next one?
The next one is a minus 3 diopter sphere with a plus 2 diopter cylinder, axis 180.
And? Plus 2, 180.
180.
This becomes minus 1. So minus 1, minus 3. This is how you will write your optical cross. Where do you use this? When you're going to do your refraction, after you've neutralized, you have the working distance lens and the power over there in place. Okay, so that's your gross value. So first you'll have to represent the gross value in the cross. So when you get a cylinder axis 90, please put it in 180. And then you're going to remove the 1.5 working distance from it in the next cross. And then you're going to remove the drug effect, if there is going to be that, in the next cross. So how do you put it there? Don't put axis 90 in 90. Put axis 90 in 180, total it, and write it. So go ahead with the rest of it.
You all can note the examples down and work it out whenever. The third, you want the optical cross? So basically, these are your examples. and the answers to it is the previous slide. If you want, you can just note it down and two of each. I've given a plus and minus cylinder form for each of these three lenses. Which one do you want? This one? Okay. So it's basically three prescriptions alone, but six different forms of writing. A short note on prisms. Prism is a portion of a refractive medium bordered by two plane surfaces inclined at a finite angle. The reflecting or the apical angle is the angle between the two surfaces. The axis of the prism is a line bisecting the angle. Base is the opposite surface. Orientation of a prism is described by the base. Base up or base out, base down or base out. Light is deviated towards the base of the prism. The shorter wavelengths are deviated more. We have two positions for orienting prisms. One is a Prentice position and the other is a position of minimum deviation. The Prentice position is a position where the face of the prism is perpendicular to the light rays. It is used for glass prisms. And the position of minimum deviation is the line of sight makes an equal angle with each prism position. It is used for plastic prisms. This is the Prentice position. To remember, Prentice position is parallel to the eye. Prentice ends with an EE for eye. It is parallel to the eye. So your one eye is exotropia. You place it parallel to the eye. The other position of minimum deviation is parallel to the face. Next we have is to correct strabismus. The apex must face towards the direction of deviation. Thus in right hypertropia, you place the prism base down over the right eye or base up over the left eye. The power of the prism can be split between two eyes. In such a case, the orientation of the prisms is opposite for the two eyes. This is only for this example, hypertropia or hypertropia. Example, a four prism diopters right hypertropia. The possible prism orientations can be four prism base down over the right eye, or four prism base up over the left eye, or two prism diopters base down over the right eye with plus two prism diopters over the left eye, base up over the left eye, or one prism diopter base down over the right eye with a three prism diopter base up over the left eye. You can divide it. If it is a higher prism, you can divide it between the two eyes. If it's a large... No. One. Let's try this out. A patient has eight prism diopters right esotropia. What are the possible prisms we can use to correct the error? Anyone can just volunteer and tell. Base out. No, this is where you might go wrong. That is only in case of hypertropia, vertical deviations. In horizontal deviations, both the prisms must face in the same direction. So you can give eight prism diopters base out over the right eye or eight prism diopters base out over the left eye. Or you can split it as four prism diopters base out on both the eyes.
Why? If you're having an esotropia, suppose the right eye is in, the left eye is not out, it's straight. Okay, so you whatever you're doing is to try to bring the image onto the straight ahead position or the eye onto the straight ahead position. In a vertical deviation, when one eye is straight, the other eye is down. When this eye comes straight, the other eye goes up, provided it is something which obeys Herring's law. So in such a case, if you put a vertical prism, it should be the opposite base because when you bring this down, this one is going to go still down. So this has to be brought up. You can't make it go still further down. If you're going to put it the same direction, it's going to go the other way around. Okay, so if it has to work the same way, this prism is split between the two eyes in opposite directions.
Special thanks to Ranjini ma'am for fixing all of this inside my head because it took a long time for me to understand and then to...
See, now you'll understand. Maybe tomorrow you'll understand. If you have to understand for your exam, please keep that material safe. and then read it then. Maybe you'll remember. Okay, if you don't, if I'm available here, we'll always have another class.